everybody. This is Ryan McClanahan with HistoryThroughCards.com. I hope you're all doing very well today. So I want to tell you about the acquisition of this particular 1957 Topps Gordie Howe. And it's something that I was really on the fence about for quite some time, just because of the very nature of the acquisition and the history behind it. The topic itself, letting go, is something that I think once you understand what happened, I think it may be that some people are very uncomfortable with this subject. And in fact, I was, which is one of the reasons why I've only told really one collector out there, one YouTuber. And I think it may be time to tell you guys about this. I think it may help somebody else, and not just a collector, but your John Q. Public or Daisy Q. Public. Whoever it is, this story might help you guys out, which is why I'm talking to you about it today. The other problem I had too is that as a journalist, we've really been kind of told, at least I have, since my earliest days as a journalist, is to not insert yourself into the story. And a lot of times I've actually done that, because my articles kind of deal with not just the peripheral of a specific card or set like this, that it's really my own journey into the hobby and collecting. And you know, the thing is, I've met so many great people through the hobby, and it's kind of hard not to talk about them or my own journeys through the hobby, because it's a human story, it's a human experience, and you know, this is too. But there are times where I actually have talked about my own personal private life in an article, experiences, in fact. And one of the things that I'm always talking about in my articles is Isaac H. Newton's third law of motion, which states, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And if I look at my own history through cards, if you will, it goes back to the days when I had a teacher back in the fourth grade who took us to a card store to learn about math and problem solving skills. And it's there that I saw a bunch of T205s and T206s and 1951 Topps. And that really kind of opened the door for a different kind of, I guess, experience that would mold me into the person I am today. I think if I didn't have that experience, I probably wouldn't be a writer today, or even on YouTube for that matter. This is still not a medium or forum that I particularly enjoy, but again, I'm not doing it for me. I'm doing it for you guys, because it may help in some form or fashion, and it's something that I wish I had growing up. In fact, my junior high and high school years were not kind to me at all, because I am disabled, and I had a lot of teachers and other people who really didn't have a whole lot of expectations for me to go to college or have a good career. And what made it even more difficult, I think, not just the fact that, you know, being disabled is not the easiest thing in the world. For me, I didn't really know a whole lot different. I did know that I was being treated differently than my peers at the time, and I took it out on my teachers. Now, right or wrong, I always paid the price for this stuff. However, when I was 17 years old, I pretty much kind of had everything mapped out as far as what I wanted to do in life. I had been working for an insurance company, which I really enjoyed. And my father had been teaching me his trade, and I had actually expectations to work with him. And unfortunately, what happened was that he had passed away quite suddenly when I was a senior in high school. And all of a sudden, within a matter of a day, I had no parents, essentially. My mother had passed away before that. And so this is what I say when I tell people that you could have full expectations about a certain aspect of your life, or you could be very healthy in one moment and then you could be disabled the next. And you just never know in which direction your life is going to take you. And in my case, my life went straight off to a different direction that I had no idea about. And not only that, you know, my father was someone who I always knew that I could get advice from, and all of a sudden didn't have that. And so between my father and this guy back here, my Uncle Mac, they always had, you know, good advice for me. And they led interesting lives. And it was something that I may talk about maybe in a book. I don't know. My father and my uncle actually, they grew up in Haight-Ashbury in the 1960s. And they knew Janis Joplin and a whole lot of other you know, singers and groups and bands from that time. And they always had great advice that I follow even to this day. But at that point in time, the only thing I really had now going for me was not even college, because a lot of my teachers really weren't expecting me to go to college. There was such low expectations placed on me that I didn't even know if I was going to graduate high school or not. And it was at that point in time that I really needed something. And, you know, me and Jesus, we don't really see eye to eye these days. And maybe at some point in time, but I had the basketball court and I had the hobby, and for me that those were two very important things, and they still remain very important. The hobby really to me has been something that has been an amazing influence on me personally, not just because of the cards, but because of the people that I've met along the way. And it's the dealers, it's the people that I've met, the collectors and their stories. And I really do kind of enjoy hearing how certain people actually obtain their cards. And a lot of times too, I have found that it may not be the particular ball player or card or object, but it's the object reminds them of either their youth or a certain period of time. And it can be a very powerful thing. Now, I didn't really have a whole lot of sentimental items of my father's. I have photographs and great stories. And, you know, me being from a storytelling family, I've kind of continued the tradition. And I really enjoy that. But I found not too long ago, I found a bunch of Series E bonds that my father had given me when I was about 5 years old. And he said, these are yours, but you'll get them when you're older. And I didn't really know exactly what I saw them, but I didn't know exactly what they were. And I kind of tucked them away, and that's where they stayed until the maturity of the bond. And even afterwards, I knew where they were and I didn't do anything with them because of sentimental reasons. It was really the only thing that I had of my father's. So come November of 2021, I had asked my uncle, who is a brilliant guy. I went to him and I asked him for some advice. What should I do with these bonds? And he kind of said that, well, first off, find out if you can actually cash them in. And secondly, at some point, you are going to have to decide what you want to do. If you want to keep them, they're not doing anything for you. And I decided to take a photograph of those bonds. So I'll have that memory still, because I remember when those bonds were picked up. And again, I was 5 years old. It was a snowy day, and it was a cold day. And so I knew that there was a show at the Shriner show coming up, and now that I did cash them in, the thing was that you have to recognize when you have to let something go. And for me, that was very difficult, particularly because I didn't have a whole lot of my father's. And so it was difficult. And this is something that I think everybody has to deal with at some point. And the older you get, the more stuff that we kind of collect over the years. And so I went through the show, and I was looking around, and I really wanted something. I wanted this money that I had now to mean more than a bond, because a bond on its own is after it's matured, it's not going to give you any more money. However, I wanted something that would be equally sentimental and something that was very special to me. So when I looked around, I came across a dealer by the name of Steve Campbell of Bax Hockey Cards. And in a recent video of the Altman show, I had a couple of photos of Steve and his information. So if you guys want, you can contact him. And I tell you one thing about Steve is he knows his hockey stuff. And again, I like hockey, and I'm always trying to learn more about the sport and the history of the sport. And he has a great selection. And so when I was looking around, I ended up seeing this particular card. And it's really a card that's been on my bucket list for a long time. And I really enjoy the design of it. And the other thing too is I've met Gordie Howe and had some great conversations with him over the years up until his passing, and he was a great guy. So I also had a few stuff that I wanted to unload, which was duplicates, and I'm not a big fan of duplicate cards for the most part. Me and John Wagner, we share the same sentiment when it comes to duplicates. John D always said, I don't like duplicates, but he's the one who gave his duplicate T206 Wagner to Jefferson Burdick, and that's how he got his Jefferson his T206 Wagner was through a duplicate. In any event, I had a 1938 Dixieland Premium of Bob Feller, another gentleman that I knew, by the way. And I'm just going to stop right there and say that through my time in the hobby, I have met so many great collectors, dealers, and a lot of great ball players as well that I've gotten to know over the years. A lot of the ball players that I did know, like Bob Feller and Duke Snider and Johnny Pesky and Dom DiMaggio, Jake LaMotta as well, I've met and talked to him a couple of times and did some artwork for a lot of these ball players, and their stories are really great. And it's one thing I really enjoyed was talking to them and getting to know these people, not just as ball players, but as citizens, and what they could teach me. And that's another aspect of the hobby which I really enjoyed. I don't really do that so much now because the majority of people that I knew have now passed on. Sometimes letting go is the most difficult thing that you can do, but sometimes it's also the most necessary as well. And for me personally, I am a very sentimental person, and basically everything that I have, everything that you see around you here, was bought out of emotion. And it's particularly a fond memory that I have, if it's that mushroom over there, or the photo of the girl, or the Empire Strikes Back poster or the poster of my uncle here, those things are very sentimental to me, and for obvious reasons that it reminds me of a specific time and an event in which I picked them up. And cards are really no exception to that. When I was probably about 15 or so, my grandmother had actually given me a 1954 Bowman Phil Rizzuto for Christmas. And I was really shocked by this because it wasn't really something that she had done often. And she didn't like my collection. She didn't have any sentimental value towards my collection at all, or any reason why I would collect sports cards. Although she did watch baseball on a regular basis, actually, and she grew up with baseball, being a fan of the Cardinals in the 1920s and 30s, and then of the Washington Senators in the 1940s, and then the Red Sox, obviously, and she was a big fan of Karl Yastrzemski. For her to go out and actually purchase this for me was something that really surprised me. Now, it wasn't the only purchase that surprised me through her. She actually facilitated a purchase of a 1958 Topps Pee Wee Reese as well, because she knew about the Brooklyn Dodgers, and she knew about Pee Wee Reese. And she said, "This is a very good card to add to your collection. I hope you keep it." And again, it was something that really surprised me quite a bit. But I do have those cards still in my collection because she gave them to me. And the one thing we really had in common was a love of baseball, even though she didn't like my collection and she didn't know why I collected or the reason for it. She actually thought that having a card was just something that you should sell, and that was it. If it's worth money, then you should sell it. And that was her thought about that, because money is worth more than cards. And you know, there was something to be said about that. However, for me, it's not about money, as I say, and it probably never will be about money either. My collection or the hobby isn't really, for me, something that I go towards the financial aspects of, even though I think that card collecting is a great way to learn about economics. And I'll always think that too. The hobby has a lot to teach you if you are willing to learn. And one of the things that you can learn a lot from is economics. And the other thing is learning how to deal with people and how to negotiate with people to get what you want. The other thing too, I really have found that the hobby is a great place to meet and talk to people. And I've met a lot of great people and a lot of great friends through the hobby, and now through YouTube, which I really enjoy. Particularly Dustin, the sports card dad, his take, and Dakota from Sports Cards Anonymous. I like their takes too. I don't really know a whole lot about modern stuff, but I'm always listening to what they have to say, because I always feel that you should be well-rounded in all subjects, and including the hobby as well. Just because you're not collecting vintage, that doesn't mean you can't learn about this stuff. I think that anytime you have an opportunity to learn, don't pass that up. And so this is one of the things I think that gets collectors and dealers kind of nervous, because I've talked to enough of these people to ask them questions off the record. So what are you intending to do with your collection if you have anything happens to you? And a lot of collectors have said that they don't know, particularly because the conversation has never came up. And in the few times the conversation has come up, they're always kind of universally, I think, nervous the fact that they have not told their significant others about their collection. And they're, I think, afraid too that their significant other might not understand anything about their collection or what they pay for it. They may be upset that they pay so much for these cards. And I really understand this because the hobby is not a cheap one for the most part, especially your vintage has not been cheap and it's only kind of going up in price. It is kind of difficult to get people who are not in the hobby to understand or kind of rationalize the value placed on these cards. And the thing is that as a collector, I understand that nobody will appreciate your collection the way you appreciate your collection. The time and energy, blood, sweat, and tears that you put into your collection is something that maybe you only understand. And so that can be a very difficult conversation to have with your significant other. So I may suggest that if you can't have this conversation with your missus, or if you're a female collector with your husband or boyfriend, you might want to consult a lawyer and see if they will add your collection to a last will and testament, which often kind of happens, or give specific instructions what is to happen to your collection if something happens to you. The other thing too is a lot of older ball players that I've known, guys like Frank Malzone of the Red Sox, he didn't really know what he wanted to do with his collection of memorabilia, and he had actually, I think in the end, he wanted to make sure that his family was taken care of financially through his collection, but didn't really know how to go about that. And eventually he actually went to a he went to an auction house to unload it. And a lot of older ball players actually do this. Bob Cousy is another ball player. He's still living, where he wanted to make sure that his grandkids were set up for college and everything was okay with them. And this is how a lot of that memorabilia gets to auction. In other cases, family members, they are passed down these family heirlooms that really don't mean a whole lot to them. And they just want the money, but they might not, again, know where to go to. And so a lot of research is actually probably should be done in this area. I always tend to write down everything that I have, the value of it, when I bought it, and especially what I intend to do with it if I end up in the field of dreams. And at some point that's going to happen. You know, the thing is, I'm not terribly concerned about when I end up in the field of dreams as a writer, you know, hanging out next to James Earl Jones there. But I'm more concerned about what I do in the meantime. You know, age is one thing, but if you don't have a good quality of life, I don't think a whole lot really matters. And I really enjoy my collection now. So I really kind of intend to leave it for another generation to enjoy and to understand that this collection means a lot to me. And the reason why it means a lot to me, which I've written down, and I continue to do so. And I always will continue to be in this hobby, whether or not I am an active participant in collecting or writing or on YouTube. No, I'm not a big fan of the YouTube here. It's not my forte, but I'm not doing this particularly for me. It is for other people. And it is something that I am really kind of struggling at. And If I'm not good at something, I'm going to try to get better at it. And I really kind of appreciate you guys sticking around and listening to what I have to say. And I'd love to hear what you guys have to say about this subject, because it is kind of a sensitive one. And if you guys have ever been in this situation and you're not entirely sure what to do, I'm always an email away, and I'll be very happy to help you guys out in any way I can, either send you to the proper people or a second opinion. And the thing is, just like collecting cards and trying to figure out if this card is a good deal or not or whatever, or if it's trimmed, if you guys are concerned about trimmed cards, always get a second opinion. And second opinions are very important, not just in the hobby, but if you're going to, like, get your car fixed, or if you're going to the doctor's office, always get a second opinion first. And that's true with the hobby too. So guys, I really appreciate this, and leave your comments down below. Give me a like and subscribe if you will. And until the next time, I will talk to you guys later. Thank you. Bye.